glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his son.
Thank you.
the Lord. Thank you for your wonderful singing.
At this time, we'll have the song, hymn number 656, O Perfect Love.
Eternal Father, we come this beautiful Sabbath morning. We come this Sabbath and every other Sabbath because you are the Creator and because you are God. Right there at the beginning, in the first garden that you yourself created, you brought the first man and woman there together as husband and wife. We recognize the institution of marriage is holy. The institution of marriage is made by you, a holy God. And such a beautiful occasion to have a holy institution taking place on a holy day. What a holy thing. We give you praise, we give you glory. And as Ken and Gloria come to unite their hearts into one, as we come, Lord, we ask for your divine blessings to be on them and this service. May all who witness be drawn closer to you. Lord, we long for the day when the marriage supper of the Lamb would have been inaugurated, and we'll all be able to be a part of that great wedding feast. Lord, we long for that day to come. Keep us faithful and true to then. In your name we pray. Amen. Invite the congregation to be seated.
We would like to draw your attention to the book of Genesis, the book of beginnings, and we will observe how God first created man and his purpose. Genesis chapter 1, and I want you to give particular attention to parts of verses 26 and 27. It says, "And God said, let us make man in our image, after our likeness." Verse 27. "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them." Verse 28. "God blessed them, and God said unto them, be fruitful and multiply." We pitch our tent in the midst of verse 27. "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them." God, in his wisdom, mercy, and majesty, decided when he made this planet to people the planet with beings that were like him. And I want you to observe what God did as we look at this wedding ceremony. God spoke to himself all through the creation story. We find God speaking to things. And everything God spoke to responded to him. God spoke to the sea. And he said, let the sea bring forth creatures. He spoke to the dry land, let the earth bring forth animals. He spoke to the sky, let the sky produce birds, winged creatures. He spoke to the heavens, let the heavens produce sun, moon, and the star. And now it was time for God to create man. God looked for the material out of which man is supposed to be made. A fish was supposed to come out of water, and birds out of the air, and animals out of the land, and the stars made up of the heavenlies. What should man be made of? What is God going to talk to? Now we find God spoke to himself. Let us make man in our own image, after our likeness. I have created several things, at least I've tried to in my feeble attempt to do so. And always when I make anything, it was always according to my likeness. I did it just the way I like it. I did it just the way I wanted to. God said, now, man must come out of me, but he must be according to my likeness. And verse 27, the verse that I want you to sink in your minds today. The Bible said, so God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. I want you to observe what God did. In creating man, God is so tremendous and so magnificent and so powerful, and his characteristics are eternally absolute, so that one entity could not contain all that God is. So when God would create man, God decided to split himself in two. Adam could not retain all that God was, so God created man as two beings. He split himself in two. So God created man in his own image. In the image of God created he him. Male and female created he them. I want you to observe that the himness of God was split in two and became the themness of man. That which was one God became two entities, male and female, so that there is in man the manly, the macho characteristics of God, and there is in woman the finer virtues of God. And God did something else that is wise in his own wisdom. Because God is split in two on this planet, male and female. In marriage, God brings himself back together in one. So God declared over man at the very beginning that the two shall be one. And the oneness of man expresses the unity of God. Really, you say amen out there? And so throughout creation, from that day forward, man has always been seeking for woman. Man, as he comes to consciousness and appears, he begins to sense that there is something missing, that there is a part of me that I need to be adjusted. There is something that I cannot do. I need somebody else to do it for me. And woman sense the same. And a girl coming of age suddenly realized, Mama, I need somebody. There is something that is missing. And we find that human beings throughout our history have been searching for soulmates, searching for that part that will make us one in Christ Jesus. Today we are here to witness such a union. We thank God for Elder Ken that he has found what many has been searching for and cannot find. We praise God today that we have found that man and woman has come together. Will you say amen out there? Ah, this is a happy day. This is a happy day. Rejoice, you people of God. When God would create Eve the first time, God did something wonderful, the Bible says. First of all, he put Adam to sleep. Isn't that beautiful? I believe a lot of marriages would be better if some of us were asleep when we get married. God decided, I'm not going to let this man hunt for anything because his eyes might deceive him, his feelings might turn him asunder. I will put him to sleep for this one. So it is that before people get married, you will observe that they go to sleep first. The first thing they do is dream and fantasize. And they build pies in the sky. And it's in one's dreams that you find the perfect mate. Isn't that right? I remember the days when I used to just dream. And I would be in church, and there she was, and one glimpse of her, and I'm gone. God put man to sleep. There are some things you must sleep on it. Don't just rush it, sleep on it. And when man went to sleep, God did something else that is interesting. God took from man, the Bible said, his rib. And I was curious about that because I discovered that God used to create man, to create woman, the most crooked bone that is in man. The rib, the most crooked. And I pondered on that for a little while, and I asked myself why. And I discovered, and I came to the fitting conclusion that God did it because God wants you to know that in marriage, no matter how crooked things went, you're still to stick together. Really, amen out there? I want us now to bow our heads where we are. And I want us to do what Adam did, just shut your eyes. Now I want you to open your eyes and look at the bride and the groom. Now move your eyes from the bride to the bride, from the bride to the groom. Nothing. Move your eyes now from the groom back to the bride. You see, you can't see her face, so there was no response from you. That's what Adam did when he saw Eve, he said, woo, man. And God said, that's her, the man with a woo. And now we have them before us, the man and the man with a woo. I saw an advertisement on TV with water with a wow, but now this is man with a woo. At this time, we are going to turn over to the officiating minister as he will pronounce them one in Christ Jesus. And our response can only be, woo. Thank you very much, Pastor Clark. We're happy to have participating with us Dr. Bujo Fletcher, who is the chief chaplain for the constabulary force. Okay. If anyone can show us cause why these two people may not be joined together in matrimony, speak up now, or else forever hold your peace. Ken, will you take Gloria to be your wedded wife? Will you live together in the holy harmony of marriage? Will you comfort her, cherish her, love her in sickness and in health, forsaking all others, forgetting all others, forget yourself, unto him shall you live?
I will.
Gloria Stewart, will you have this man, the one whose arm you're holding, to be your wedded husband, to live together in the holy state of marriage? Will you love him, comfort him, honor and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep yourself only to him as long as you both shall live?
I do.
Who gives this woman to be married to this man? The Lord. Thank you very much. I'm going to ask that you face each other. No, keep holding your bouquet, no problem. I'm going to ask that you look into each other's eyes. As we share these important moments, joyous but important moments. And so, Mr. Wright, you're going to repeat after me as of now. I, give your name.
I, Ken Oswin Wright.
Take you.
Gloria.
Gloria Audrey Clairmont. To be my wife. I promise before God and these friends to be. Your loving and faithful husband. To share with you in plenty and in want. In joy and in sorrow. In sickness and in health. And to join with you. So that together. We may serve God and others. As long as we both shall live. God be my help.
Help.
To you, Miss Clairmont, you will repeat after me as of now. I give your name. Gloria Audrey Clairmont. Take you. Ken Oswin Wright. To be my husband. I promise before God and these friends. To be your loving and faithful wife. To share with you in plenty and in want. In joy and in sorrow.
In joy and in sorrow.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and health.
And to join with you.
And to join with you.
So that together we may serve God and others.
Together we may serve God and others.
As long as we both shall live.
As long as we both shall live.
God be my help.
God be my help. Help.
What God has joined together, let no man put asunder. For as much as Ken has been right, and Gloria, Audrey, Clairmont have consented together in holy marriage and have joined hands, we as ministers of the gospel declare you married, husband and wife, in the name of the Father, in the name of the Son, in the name of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. You can put your hands together for them. Invite the congregation to stand with us as we have the prayer of dedication. Let us pray. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for this beautiful institution. Indeed, an extension of the divine attribute. The one, the plurality of God has been replicated in the plurality of man. Yet, man is one with his wife, and so is God among himself. Help us, Lord, that as this marriage progresses, indeed they will act as one in every aspect. Though they are different, though their roles are separate, they are one in purpose, one in goal, one in aspirations. Lord, we ask that you bind them with your love. Bind them with your Holy Spirit's presence. We know the devil is already working to destroy this another marriage. But in the name of Jesus, we pray to keep back the forces of evil from this marriage. And let nothing but your Spirit be between them, which will only help to cement their lives together. Be with their extended family too. Because it is not just two persons are getting married, but two families. So bind the families together. Pray that they will be together until death do their part. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. Lord, make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. Lord, lift up his countenance upon you both and give you his peace, both now and forevermore. Amen. Please be seated as they go now to, before God they're married, but before man they need to put pen to paper. And so they will do that at this time.
children on the journey of the narrow road, and those who've gone before us light the way, cheering on the faithful, encouraging the weary, their lives a stirring testament to God's sustaining grace. Surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us run the race not only for the prize, but for those who've gone before us. Let us leave to those behind us the heritage of faithfulness passed on through godly light. Oh, may all come behind us, find us a faith of all. May the power of our devotion light their way. That we live, lead them to believe, and the lives we live, inspire them to obey. Oh, may all who come behind us find us faithful. After all, our hopes and dreams have come and gone, and our children sift through all we've left behind. May the clues that they discover and the memories they uncover become the light that leads them through the road we all must find. Oh, may all come behind us, find us a faithful. May the power of our devotion light their way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. Find us a faithful. May the power of devotion light the way. May the footprints that we leave lead them to believe, and the lives we live inspire them to obey. Oh, may all come behind us find us faithful. Oh, may all come behind us find us a faith. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is my distinct pleasure and privilege to present to you, I wouldn't say the first time, because he was married before, but Mr. and Mrs. Ken Wright. Congratulations. Congratulations, sir. May God bless you as you walk this journey called marriage. Congratulations, Mrs. Wright. And you said you are double right. Very well. All right. The pastor has something to give to the couple.
Definitely. And to every newly wedded couple, it must be presented to the person the title deed. Everybody must have the deed to the property. Without the title, then you have no rights. And so I have with me the deed. And as is customary, we now present the deed to the groom and his bride. Let's try it again then. I'll give it to the lady, but let's try it again. We present the deed to the newly wedded couple, and we are giving it to the man, a yard. Praise the Lord. Now we watch what man, a yard, I'm going to do with it. Amen, amen, amen. He did the exact thing that is expected. Praise the Lord, church. And we wish them all the best in the Lord. And at this time, we'll continue. But remember, no greeting of them now. We will do that after the divine.
Right. So as soon as the recessional, they come right back, sit back in church, and the program continues. But before we do that, I'm going to ask that you face, please assist the bride with those things in her hands. She needs to be hands-free. I'm going to ask that you face each other. Face each other. Are all the cameras ready? We're not blocking anybody. Mr. Wright, Elder Wright, you may greet and kiss your bride. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. and Mrs. Kenwright, put your hands together for them. You will have more a little later. Recessional.
Sabbath Church. These are the announcements for May 25th, 2019. Sorry. We just witnessed the marriage of the newlywed rites, and we would like to congratulate them as a church and welcome to the family, Mrs. Wright. Tomorrow, the 26th of May, will be our harvest and Thanksgiving service here under the theme, Harvest in the Praises of the Saints. On June 1st, there will be a personal ministry leader and a secretary, as well as Sabbath school leader and a secretary training at the Old Road SDA Church. It will be all day and lunch will be provided. On June 8th, Old Road SDA will be having their music day. And Old Road SDA on the 15th will be having their harvest and Thanksgiving service beginning at 9:15 a.m. On the 15th of June, the Youth Ambassador 2019 and Jamaica Night will be held. This is a part of the Youth Department's program. The Youth Department thanks the church for the support in our Youth Day celebration. We acknowledge your support of wearing the assigned colors and your encouragement and prayers. Please continue to support and encourage our youth. Keep us in your prayers. Band programs for July. On the 6th, we will have Ozea. On the 13th, we will have Job. And on the 27th of July, Amos will be doing their band program. There will be no Pathfinder Club tomorrow. Amen. Tomorrow, we will have our prayer and fasting beginning at 6 a.m. and we will end at 10 a.m. Bible class this afternoon will be done by Elder Beckford, Vespers, Sister Priscilla Lindsay. Sunday night, we'll be having a guest, and Wednesday night, Brother Granville Delion. Sister Ina Williams, her husband fell off a scaffold. He broke his hand. He also tore a ligament. And the church is please asked to remember him in our prayers. My aunt, that's Louise Drake Lewis, her funeral will be tomorrow at 10 a.m. at the Green Pastor Seventh-day Adventist Church in Sandy Bay. And as I said, we begin at 10. Please remember to pray for and visit with our sick and shut-ins and those on our prayer list. These persons are Marion Taylor, James Taylor, Dahlia Rose, Edith Reed, Noel Bonick, and Lenora Bryan. On our prayer list, we have Ivy Heron, Hyacinth Orr, Edna Jackson, Carol Street, Vivian Anderson, Shadi Harris, Noel Grace, Bobby Campbell, Beverly Riley, and Lenord Brown. Have a blessed Sabbath.
This Sabbath is indeed the last Sabbath of the month of May, but tomorrow is not the first Sunday in the month of June. So it means that the fasting is not tomorrow, it is next week. The fasting that was announced a while ago is not for tomorrow, it's for next week. So please bear that in mind. I don't know if you have heard, but the piano sounds a lot better this morning, because it was tuned during this week. And we need to say thanks to, I know they don't want us to say, but we have to anyway, Brother and Sister Spence, who took it on themselves to do it for us. And Brother and Church, And I congratulate Brother Spence, Brother and Sister Spence. They have done a number of things for us since the start of the year. They would prefer us not to say, but we need to, right? Brother Spence, Sister Spence, thank you very much. I went to Sister Laidlaw last week. And you hear more about that afterwards. She's at home. I'll tell you more. On behalf of the church, I'd like to say, Ken, your decency, sincerity, and kind soul will stay with us forever. We're aware of the blessings of knowing and loving you. A great and noble man you are. The best friend a man could ever hope to have. All the best as you embark on your new life. Audrey, as a wife of Ken, you automatically are a friend of ours. We welcome you to the fellowship at Kitson Town Seventh-day Adventist Church. And brethren on the outside, you can tell them best wishes. This time we're going to call the church to order. I'd like you to stand, please, brethren. Praise is rightfully yours, God in Zion. Vows to you must be fulfilled, for you answer prayers. The church is now called to order.
Pray. Our Father in heaven, again, as we come before you this morning, it is a high day in Zion. As we come before you on this blessed Sabbath day, we just wish to pour out our souls before you so that we may receive a blessing from on high. Be with us this day in this church in Jamaica. Be with us here, and may we always cling unto the robe of righteousness that you may cover our sins. And Father in heaven, be with us now for this divine hour, so that we may draw closer unto thee and unto salvation. Be with us in this church. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
It is my privilege this morning to welcome us all to divine service. I want to welcome the newest couple in Kitson Town, Brother and Sister Wright. On behalf of the pastor, the members of the Kitson Town Church, I want to say a warm welcome. Heaven is rejoicing today. Amen. To continue our worship, we'll turn our hymnals to number one. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation.
Thank you.
I'll ask you to be seated, please. Let me give you a few reasons why we need to praise God. One, Brother Joseph would love to have been in church with us this morning. I told you earlier he fell into a pit, and we thought he had broken his legs. Thankfully, that has not happened. Amen. Yeah, but he still can't be here with us this morning. Let me give another reason before we introduce the song. I was listening on the radio and I heard how long it was going to take for us to get rain. And the scientists, and I keep on telling people, you know, that these people who can't read the weather, they're not doing a very good job of it, you know. I tell Stephanie Salwai, where is she? I'm Bridging. I heard how long it was going to take and how dry it was going to be and how hot we were going to be. And yesterday, people in Spanish Town almost drowned. Isn't God just good and different? Amen. Bridging, as Brother Spence comes to sing, I don't know what he's going to sing, but whatever he sings, it's reason enough for us to give thanks.
Give me a heart like thine. Give me a heart that knows no sin. Give me thy grace to do thy will. Pardon and cleanse this heart of mine, Lord. Give me a heart like thine. Come to my soul, blessed Jesus. Hear me, oh Savior.
Forward. God may entrust men with money and possession, but because of this, they are not to lift themselves up. All they have, they all in trust. It is lent them by God that they may develop a character like his. They are on trial. God wants to see whether they will prove themselves worthy of his eternal riches. Our Heavenly Father, as your people are about to give to the running of the church, we ask the Lord that there will be a special blessing for what is given to thee. Remember those who give in their hearts. Bless everything that is done to thee, dear Lord. In Jesus' name. Deacons, you may go and collect these island offerings. Standing for the scripture reading. The scripture reading comes to us from Joshua 24, 14 and 15. Joshua 24, 14 and 15. Finds Haman. I read in your hearing. Now therefore, fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth, and put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. 15 and last, and if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your father served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Eternal God and our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. We thank you, Lord, for this wonderful Sabbath. We thank you for journeying mercies, for your angels who took care of us and have brought us from near and far to be here today to worship you. As we come, O Lord, we pray that you will remove far from us all the impediments that will prevent us from worshiping you in spirit and in truth. Forgive us of our many sins and trespasses, and cleanse us from all unrighteousness, so that as we worship you, our worship will be accepted. We want to thank you for all the goodies that you have given us through the week. We want to pray for those who have been hailing because of sickness. We pray, Lord, as the chief, the one who have walked this earth and have healed many, and still have the power to heal. We pray, Lord, that you will look down from heaven above and touch your sick ones today. I pray for Pastor Casey Henry. I notice that he's not so well. I ask you, Lord, to be with him even now in a special way. I have a request in my hand. One mother is asking for prayer for her daughter and I put her before you, Lord, whatever is the situation. I know you're the great God of heaven. There is no situation that is greater than you. And so I put her into your care and ask you, Lord, to do whatsoever pleases you. Let your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And dear Lord, I put before you now the one that is appointed to break the bread of life. I ask you, Lord, to hide him behind the cross of Calvary, where the ground is level. And as he opened his mouth, put words therein. And help us to give attentive and a listening ears, so that as your word come forth, it will find lodgment in our hearts. And we'll be endeavoring to go and to tell others about you, to come and see you, and to know you, whom to know is life eternal. And so, Lord, we invite your Holy Spirit to take charge of this service. And we ask that your angels will take guard around the sanctuary to back back the forces of evil. And so that our worship will not be in vain, but our worship will praise you because you inhabit praise. We thank you, Lord, for your listening ears. We thank you for your sacrifice on Calvary's cross. We thank you, Ancient of Days, for sending and allowing your Son to die on Calvary's cross. And so, Lord, we praise your name. We magnify your name. We glorify your name today. For Christ's sake, we pray. Amen.
I thought you'd say amen for that. Right. And I hope going from now on is going to be the same. And for those who came in late, we welcome you. Welcome you all to church this morning. The Bible is replete with stories of persons who are struggling or who were struggling, and it was the use of a song which helped them through their troubles. Now, we don't have to go to the Bible. You, in your life, use songs to help you in your walk each day, don't it?
Yes.
Right. This morning, we're going to do the same. We're going to find a song that can be used to offer you some hope. Because sometimes people come to church and you see their faces and they're smiling. But that smile covers a multitude of ills. I don't know what you're going through this morning, but whatever it is, let me tell you that you're at the right place. You're here for a blessing, and the Lord normally does that. He normally blesses his people. This morning, taking part in the worship, we have Sister Shereen Smith. She's on my right. She has not yet done her part. Beside her, Sister Joan Pinnock, who told me this morning that she's next. After Brother Rice, she's next. Well, I don't know what next means. You obviously know, because you laugh. I really don't know, but she's next. Brother Angus is on my left, and beside him is Brother Ella Facy from the Holy Old Church, who prayed for us this morning. You know my name. My name is Errol Martin. It hasn't changed. Still Errol Martin. This morning, I can't introduce the speaker, because I don't know him. But I do know that anybody who speaks on God's behalf is a good man. But luckily for us, we have his father who will welcome him this evening. And what am I looking for? I will introduce him. That's what I'm looking for. We'll introduce him this morning. Brother Wright, your time, sir.
A very funny appellation. Kind of took me by surprise. His father. Our speaker this morning is a child of God. And that's what qualifies him to speak to us and to himself. More specifically, he is Elder Victor Clairmont from the Collinswood Church in New Jersey. And he came all the way from there to be sure that he is here to see that his mother married the right person. And so it is my pleasure to really introduce, as a speaker, Elder Clairmont. He is a preacher. He is an evangelist. He is an international singer as well. And I'm sure that you have been blessed by his presentation musically, and that you will be blessed by the preaching of the word. I only ask that you open up your hearts and allow the Spirit of God to do what he does best, to convict, to change, to convert, so that we can be a glory to all those who are here. Permit me, since I might not be able to speak to you as a group, I would like to say thank you very much, wait for it, on behalf of my wife and myself. For all that you have done, we wanted everything to be very simple and straightforward, but some people have gone, not overboard, but have gone the extra mile to make things much easier. And I want to express our thanks to you all. I just also would like to include in this Pastor Budu Fletcher, who God sent at the right time to take up a position that I couldn't or nobody else could at the time. And in that same vein, as he participated in the ceremony, I am asking for your prayers in a special way for Casey Henry, who is resting in there at the moment. Please, we will like to say that there is no reception, but there is a fellowship lunch afterwards. So God bless you. Now, don't anticipate the physical food. Be ready for the spiritual at this time and to set our hearts attune and in the right frame of mind. We are going to be listening to one of our songbirds who has blessed us since morning, Sister Lisa.
Let's worship the Lord. We lift our hands and we praise the Lord. He's worthy to be praised. I worship you. we sing. Say, Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are. Say, Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Would you say amen again, church?
Amen.
Not too shabby. My name is Elder Victor Vincent Clairmont, all the way from New Jersey in the good old U.S. of A. And I want to see if I can do this another way. God is good
all the
time. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Amen.
It is such a privilege to be here, Kitson Town Seventh-day Adventist Church. It is good to be home in Jamaica. For those of you that may not know, the wonderful lady that was married to Mr. Ken Wright is my mother. And it is good to see many family members and friends here today. And just so you don't know, my grandmother who has passed away, her name was Victoria Stewart. And she went to the Hagley Park Seventh-day Adventist Church. And when she was a teenager, she converted from Hinduism to Seventh-day Adventism after hearing a camp meeting one day in Kingston, Jamaica. And that began a generation of generations of Seventh-day Adventists. And I am standing here today because the good women of my family preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it is my privilege to be here before you today. And I just want to reread that scripture you heard this morning. It comes from us from the book of Joshua. Joshua chapter 24. And I will read verse 14 in your hearing. Now therefore fear the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in truth. And put away the gods which your fathers served on the other side of the flood and in Egypt, and serve ye the Lord. And if it seem evil unto you to serve the Lord, choose you this day whom ye will serve, whether the gods which your forefathers served that were on the other side of the flood, or the gods of the Amorites, in whose land ye dwell. But as for me and my house, I will serve the Lord. Let us pray. Father in heaven, again as your humble servant comes before you, I ask that you take a hot coal off of the altar and place it upon my mouth. Not I, but Christ. Let your word be heard today and not my own. I am a nobody, Lord, but you are a somebody. I am nothing, but you are the creator of the heavens and the earth, the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. And I ask now as I bring the word of the Lord to the masses and the congregation today, that their hearts be open to receive your word. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. So I want to begin with a little story. And if you know it, don't spoil it. One day, a pastor was approached by a gentleman. And the gentleman came to the pastor and said, good sir, my brother has passed away, and I need you to come to the funeral and do the eulogy. And the pastor looked at this man, and he knew this man was of unsavory character. He knew that this man was not the best crowd to be among, and so the pastor looked at him and said, I don't know if I want to do that. And the gentleman said, no, Pastor, wait, listen. I have a lot of money that I'm willing to give to you. And I just need you to say one thing about my brother who passed away, that he was a saint. And so the pastor looked at the man and said, all right, fine, I'll do it. So the day of the funeral came, and everybody who was somebody was there. Hollywood actresses were there. The mayor and the governor were there. The who's who came to this funeral. And as the casket was laid bare before the congregation, the pastor got up, and he looked down upon that casket, and he pointed and said, this man here was a drunkard. He was a wine bibber. He was an adulterer. He was all these evil things. But compared to his brother, he was a saint. Be careful what the man of God will say to you today. And I have some good news and I have some bad news for you today. And I want to begin with the bad news. Our subject this morning is the family of God. The family of God. And would you open with me your Bibles? And we are going to 1 Samuel. I hope you do have your Bibles with you this morning, yes? I know we all have smartphones, and whether it's the iPhone, the Galaxy, or a digicel phone, whatever phone you have, it's good to have the Word of God in your hands. Would you say amen? Amen. And I want you to open up to 1 Samuel, and we're going to chapter 2. And we'll begin in verse 12, and I want to set the stage for you for a second. There was a man in Israel by the name of Eli. And Eli was a judge among judges. He was the high priest. And Eli was a man that would train a gentleman by the name of Samuel. And Eli was the clergy. He was the pastor. He was the man of God. But there was something wrong with Eli and his household today. And it says in verse 12, Now the sons of Eli were sons of Belial. They knew not the Lord. And the priest's custom with the people was that when the man offered sacrifice, the priest's servants came with the flesh while it was seething, and the flesh shook with three teeth in hand. I'm reading from the King James Version. Ye oldie King James, I hope you can keep up with me. Verse 14, and they struck it into the pan or kettle or cauldron or pot, and all the flesh shook brought up. The priest took for himself, because back in the day when sacrifices were brought before the high priest, the priest got a small portion of it so he could feed himself, so he could feed his family, because a tenth of the tithe belongs to God. But here we have something different going on, because in verse 15, as the Israelites come forth, it says, as they burnt the fat, the priest's servants came and said unto the man that sacrificed, Eli's son speaking, give the flesh roast unto me, for I will not have sodden flesh of thee, but raw. And as Seventh-day Adventists, we know that any time you eat meat, if you eat meat and are not a vegetarian by now, I'll be honest with you, I am a normal Adventist. Can I be honest? I grew up with a mother that was born here in Jamaica, and she cooked curry goat, rice and peas, jerked chicken, roti and dal. It's hard to give that up. And my grandmother cooked the same thing. And so come Thanksgiving and Christmas time, you can just smell the delight of cooked beef, cooked goat, cooked chicken, cooked rice and peas. And don't get me wrong, I love my mangoes. I love the fruit of Jamaica. Jackfruit. I like it all. Ackee and saltfish. Mmm. You all would never think I was half American. My father was from Illinois in the US of A. His parents were English, German, and Lithuanian. My mother's side is West Indian and Jamaican. It is a confluence of blood that stands before you today. But I know as an Adventist, if you have meat, you must cook the meat. And the sons of Eli, these sons of Belial, wanted it raw. They didn't care for it to be cooked. And you see, for a high priest to do this was an abomination. You know, some people love their pork. And they eat their pork and they don't cook it right. And because they don't cook it right, trichina is inside the piggy. And as they get older, eating pork day after day, they think they got arthritis, but they got hogitis. And so when these men of God are doing that which they shouldn't do, they are doing blasphemy in God's house. And so let us see what happens, because Eli was a man of God, but he couldn't order his house after himself. Think about that. Men of God, pastors, elders, deacons, people that sometimes are doing their best to serve the Almighty, forget about their family. Not recognizing that the family is a reflection of God here on earth. So Eli's sons were corrupt. And now I want you to jump ahead now. We're going to chapter 4. And I'm going to set the stage for you real quick. Because the Israelites were always fighting with the Philistines. And before we get into this chapter, just know that Israel fought the Philistines and then lost the battle. And in chapter 4, we find out that Israel, seeing that they were losing, decided a very bad strategy. They said, and I'm going to look at verse 3. And when the people were come into camp, and the elders of Israel said, wherefore hath the Lord smitten us this day before the Philistines? Let us fetch the ark of the covenant of the Lord out of Shiloh unto us. And when it cometh among us, it may save us out of the hands of our enemies. Did you catch that? The holy ark of God, where the Shekinah glory of God touched, where golden seraphims and cherubims covered, where the rod of Aaron was inside and had budded, where the Ten Commandments, the second ones, because the first one Moses threw down in his wrath and destroyed, and then he had to make a second one, was in that ark. The Israelites are treating like a common trinket. How many times have you seen people wearing maybe a lucky rabbit's foot, a cross, not worship, not realizing the Savior who died on a cross? Little trinkets and knickknacks that are supposed to bring them good luck. They're treating the Ark of the Covenant like a trinket. And what happens in this chapter? It says they go to fight the Philistines in chapter 4. And I'm now moving to a different verse. And moving ahead now, we find out that the Israelites still lose the battle. And that God allows the Ark of the Covenant to be taken by the Philistines. And as the battle is lost, it says in verse 11 that the Ark of God was taken, the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were slain. And as we now jump to verse 17, it says, and the messenger that came out of the battlefield answered and said, Israel is fled before the Philistines. He's now reporting back to Eli, the high priest. And there has been a great slaughter among the people, and thy two sons, Hophni and Phinehas, are dead. And the Ark of God is taken. And it came to pass when he made mention of the Ark of God that he fell, Eli, from off his seat backwards by the side of the gate, and his neck broke and he died. For he was an old man and heavy, and he had judged Israel 40 years. We're talking about the family of God today. We're talking about how in this situation, this is the bad news, that even if you're a man of God, if you do not look out for your wife, look out for your sons, look out for your daughters, they may go astray. What is that old scripture? Train up a child in the ways and he shall not depart. But God also says that fathers, do not provoke your sons and daughters to wrath. How many times have we been too strict and our children hate us for it? Vice versa, how many times have we been too lenient and our children are spoiled? I come from a country where parents are afraid to discipline their children. I don't know how it is here in Jamaica, but I come from a place where if you touch a child the wrong way, you might hear the police knocking on your door the next. And we've lost that old time religion. We've decided to go with a new phase of the world. We've decided that maybe men shouldn't be men and women shouldn't be women, but we've decided that you can be anything you want. But God said, man and woman, I created them. And Jesus himself in the New Testament ratified with his first miracle, a marriage. That's hard to preach these days. And let me say something to you. It doesn't matter what your sin is, God loves you. It doesn't matter what sin you're dealing with, God will be there for you. It doesn't matter if you're dealing with drug addiction, sexual infidelity, homosexuality. It matters not. All must submit to the cross of Christ and all can be healed. We forget that we are great sinners and God's a great Savior. Now I want to get to some good news. Turn with me to the book of Ruth, right before the book of 1 Samuel. And just so you know, the book of Ruth and Samuel and Judges around harvest time typically was read together. And the book of Ruth is a love story. And as we see, I want us to go to chapter 1 and let us jump to verse 13. And Ruth was not an Israelite. Ruth was a Moabitess. She was not of the household of faith like Eli's son. She was a foreigner with foreign gods, with foreign practices, with foreign ideas, but she had a mother-in-law by the name of Naomi, who worshiped the one true God. A mother-in-law who kept the faith in a foreign land. A mother-in-law that, like my grandmother who converted from Hinduism, a culture of 300 million gods, to the one true faith. Naomi set the stage for the family so that when the husbands passed away and the sons were gone, Ruth looked at Naomi and probably saw Jesus. And so we read here in verse 13 now, would you tarry for them till they are grown? Would you stay from having husbands? This is Naomi talking to her two daughters. Nay, my daughters, for it grieveth me much for your sakes that the hand of the Lord has gone out against me. And both the daughters lifted up their voice and wept. And Orpah, the other sister of Ruth, kissed her mother-in-law. But Ruth, catch this, cleaved unto her. And she said, behold, thy sister is gone unto her people, unto her gods. Return now thou after thy sister. And Ruth said, "Entreat me not to leave thee, or to return from following after thee. For whither thou goest, I will go. And where thou lodgest, I will lodge. Thy people shall be my people, and thy God my God. Where thou diest, will I die, and there will I be buried. The Lord do so unto me, and more also, if aught be death, part thee from me." And this young, beautiful woman who was a widow named Ruth cleaved unto Naomi, just like the poor woman in the New Testament cleaved unto the robe of Christ for healing. Here we have somebody who is secular, who is pagan, now accepting the God of Israel. And as she journeys to the land of Israel, she meets a man named Boaz. See, there's a few things we learn about Ruth the Moabitess. She was a hard worker. She worked in the fields to provide for her mother, because she swore an oath unto her, saying, "I would take care of you." And I want to show you something. Did you know that Ruth's name is indeed the genealogy of Jesus? Oh, yes, you did. Where do we find that? Turn with me to Matthew chapter 1, verses 5. If you don't believe me, because you should always check what the minister says, yes? You don't know if I'm lying to you if you don't check your Bibles, yes? Satan comes with a bit of truth and a whole heap of lies. So in Matthew chapter 1, verses 5, I will read to you what it says very, very quickly. And I'll start with verse 4, actually. "And Aram begot Amminadab, and Amminadab begot Nahshon, and Nahshon begot Salmon, and Salmon begot Boaz of Rahab, and Boaz begot Obed of Ruth, and Obed begot Jesse, and Jesse begot King David, and David begot Solomon." Right there in the beginning of Matthew, Ruth, a Moabitess, a pagan that accepted the one true God, is in the family of God. How many of you remember in the book of Joshua, as the walls of Jericho came tumbling down, there was a woman in Jericho by the name of Rahab. And Rahab was, as we know, perhaps what we call a lady of the night. She was somebody of unsavory character. But because the spies of Israel came one day to scout out the land and give a report, and because she saved them from being found out, she said unto the spies, "When you go back," I'm paraphrasing now, "when you go back, tell Joshua that there's somebody in here that's heard about the God that brought Egypt low, that crossed the River Jordan, that parted a Red Sea. I have heard a God in heaven exists, and I want to follow him." And so when the walls of Jericho come tumbling down, only one small little portion of the wall stays up, where a lady of a night who decided to give her life to the one true God lived. And that lady is also in the genealogy of Christ. And so here you have a harlot, here you have a Moabitess, here you have people so far from God in the household of faith. Never let somebody so far away from God trick you into believing they can't be saved. Always remember that God is a great Savior, even if we're great sinners. It doesn't matter what you've done in the family of God, he takes all. He doesn't care about your blood. He cares about your heart. Rend your hearts before God Almighty, and he will accept you. That's why when Jesus, when he goes through Gethsemane, and he goes through his trials and tribulations, and he is nailed to a cross, he is crucified between a thief and a murderer. And the murderer mocks Christ, but the thief says, "Man, what are you doing? We deserve our fate." Crucifixion was the most extreme torture a person could face back in the days of Rome. They were masters of pain. For when they crucified you, we normally typically think that they nailed you through the hands, but they normally would nail you right here, where there's a muscle. And when you hammer that muscle, it's like fire going up and down your arm. They hammered you in between the shins and in the foot. And so when you were lying on a cross, you had to continually boost yourself up just to get breath because it was so painful. And yet there was a thief on the cross at the last moment that said, man, we deserve to be here, but this man, Jesus, he's done nothing wrong. And he said that all famous saying, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And that day the thief on the cross was saved. He wasn't a Jew. He was a Gentile. Christ had to deal with stiff-neckedness of the Israelite nation all the time. Because by the time Christ comes, the family of God was only seen as those who were of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. But they forgot about Ruth. They forgot about Rahab. They didn't realize that when God came, that John the Baptist himself said, when he was approached by the Pharisees, they said, we are sons of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And John the Baptist, the forerunner of Christ, said, God can take any of these stones and make them a son of Abraham. But John was one crying in the wilderness. And when Christ comes, he began to show the Jewish people that it is not just blood lineage that matters, it's the heart of the person. I won't keep you here too long today, saints. I know it's been a long day. But I want you to catch this vision of glory that Christ has. Christ doesn't care about the fact of how long you've been in the church. Eli was in the church a long time. His sons were still damned. In fact, Samuel, who came after Eli, Samuel was one of the greatest judges that existed. If Moses represented the law, and Elijah, the prophets, Samuel represents the judges. But Samuel learned from Eli, but what he also took away was the parenting. Because Samuel had two sons too, that walked not in the way of the Lord. And they were worse than the sons of Eli. In 1 Samuel it says that they took bribes and filthy liquor. They were mobsters in the church. They came and they extorted the congregation. And that's why when the children of Israel come before Samuel, they say, you know what? This judgeship that God set up, it ain't working. We look at all the pagan nations around us and they say, have a king. Give us a king to rule us. And when Samuel goes before God, God says unto Samuel, Samuel, give them a king, but realize this. It is not you they have rejected, they have rejected me. All because Samuel couldn't keep his kids in line. The whole trajectory of Israel changed. And we see in the Bible that some of the best families that cleaved together were those that obeyed Father. We remember Abraham and his son Isaac. But even Abraham made a mistake in his family. A mistake that haunts us to this day. For he took away, wanting to help God. How many times have we wanted to help God? How many times do we do things before we pray? And then we say, well, you know, God will follow by prayer and answer. Sarah, Abraham's good wife, decided they were too old to have a child. So she said she'd help him out. Let me help God out. He'd get nothing. Maybe God kind of forgot about the promise he gave to us in our old age. And so he gave the handmaids Hagar. And they had a child named Ishmael. And that one mistake lost peace in the Middle East to today. Because our Islamic brothers and sisters in the Middle East traced their line through Abraham, not through Isaac, but through Ishmael. Sometimes you don't need to help God out. You let God help you out. And we've got to understand that as we speak about families, that we should always, even those that have gone astray, like the prodigal son, we pray for them. We be on our knees for them. My grandmother, till the day she died, was always on her knees, praying for her children. Why? Because she was a faithful woman of God. My grandmother was a flawed woman, but when it came time to pray, she unburdened her soul before the Lord. To the point that I guarantee that when Samuel's mother came and Eli saw her praying fervently for a child, she thought she was drunk. But little did he realize that when you rend the heart, you cannot keep anything in. That's why God looked at the Pharisees and said, they give all this money, but to the woman that gives her last mite, that is a woman that will follow after me. It's not about being a Jew. It's not about being a Gentile. It's simply about following God. That's why Christ says, I am the vine. You are the branches. And for those that you that join are grafted into the family of faith. I'm closing now. We are grafted into a family of faith that has existed in Christianity for 2,000 years. Before that was Judaism for 3,000 years. And the early Christian church under the power of Rome. One of their greatest successes as the family of God. As they were thrown to lions. As Nero put them in his garden and lit them on fire to light up his garden at night. I don't know if you know that saying, Nero played the fiddle while Rome burned. I don't know if they had fiddles back then, but he certainly lit the Christians on fire. But yet, the greatest victory of Christianity to this day was the downfall of Rome and the uplifting of Christ. One of the things that the family of God first did was that it looked at the arenas of the gladiatoria. It looked at those areas where Christians and convicts were thrown into the den of lions and torn apart. Where people were killed and they tore it down saying, you must remember that all are equal in the sight of God. And when Christ took a child and put it on his knee and said, be like this child, for if you do something against this child, better a millstone be hung about your neck than what I will do to you. And Christianity has always had since its foundation this idea that children are of God. See, in Rome back then, nobody cared about children. It would think of a circle. In the middle was the king. Outside was his counselors, typically male. And on the fringes of society was the women and children. If you didn't make it to age 14, you weren't considered anything. But Christ came and turned it all around. And he said, these children, you must be like them. You must have a faith of a child if you want to get into heaven. You must have a faith like Ruth that cleaved unto Naomi. You must have a faith like Rahab, that when the walls of your life come tumbling down, Christ will keep you standing tall. And that's why today when we think about the family of God is under attack in a way we've never seen in history. I come from a land, like I said before, where some men don't know if they're men, and some women don't know if they're women. But I know this. Give your identity over to God and he'll show you who you are. I don't know about you, but it is one thing to have all the pleasures of this life. It is one thing to have the world in the palm of your hand and lose your soul. And that's why as I stand before you, it is not because of my own power. It is not because of my own will. It is because God reached down and touched me. And he did that through a mother that would pray for me day and night. A mother that when her older husband ran out on the family in America, she kept the family together by working day after day, night after night, to put food on the table for me so that one day I would be able to go and study at Westminster in Princeton, New Jersey in music.